Good morning and welcome to Elm Park Baptist Church. Wherever you are, whoever you are, whatever time this is, welcome to this time. We are celebrating God. We are going to be joining together as scattered people to praise and worship God, to pray together, to hear from God's word, to receive his encouragement and strength to go on following him and believing in him this week. May I welcome you to this time. We pray that this time together will be a source of help and strength and comfort and blessing to you. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for the week that's just gone. We thank you for the ups and the downs. And we worship you today. May you come and be part of this time together. In a special way, reveal yourself to each one of us. We pray for your blessing. May we experience your presence and your love. We open our hearts and our minds to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you.
The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Oh, come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
We're going to join together in prayer. Let us pray. Father God, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. And today as we gather, we remember this last week that's gone by. We give you thanks, Lord, for all of the things that have happened. Thank you for our lives. Thank you for our health. Thank you for our families. Thank you for what you've given us. Thank you for our homes. Thank you for all your mercies. We're going to say together, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also praise you this morning, Lord, for who you are. We think about your amazing love. We think about your power. We think about your greatness. We think about the fact that you are everywhere at the same time, that you know everything, that you are holy, that you are mighty, that you are our shepherd, and that you are great. And we worship you and praise you this morning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring before you today, Lord, people that need you. People that we know, situations that we know about, people who need healing, people who need help and support from you. We bring them to you now. We ask for your power to be made perfect in their weakness. We ask for you to bless them more than we can imagine. Lord, we bring to you the things that we cannot do, and we put them into your hands. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift up to you our government, Boris Johnson, leaders in this country, local leaders, local council, teachers, head teachers, parents, families, workplaces, church leaders. Lord, we lift up all of our leaders. We pray for wisdom, for help, for blessing from you as they navigate, as they make decisions, as they care, as they lead. Help them to make the right decisions. We commit our country into your hands. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring these prayers before you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I'm going to say that he hasn't changed my life so much as completely replaced it. The life that I live now is not my life. It's a life of him inside me. And that has made all the difference in the world. And I just pray that others will realize that he's come so that we might have life, he said, and have it to the full. I'm no longer who I was. I am now who he intends me to be in Christ Jesus. I'm new. I'm changed. I'm redeemed. I have a hope. I have a future. And all because of him. It's not him added to my life, but my life completely gone and his life now living in me.
What has he done for me? What difference has he made in my life? And I just have to say, just like everybody else, we've been through a lot in this family. We've had 2 major spinal surgeries. We've had lung cancer. We've had job losses. We've had things that everybody else has. So what's the difference in the fact that I follow Jesus and I worship him? And the difference for me is what he promised, that he will give me life abundantly. And because of that, I see everything from his point of view. I see everything from his love, and he carries me through every day. So I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you, Jesus, for what you did on the cross.
Hello everyone, my name is Uri Enriquez and I'm from Mexico City, and I want to tell you how Jesus has changed my life. You'll see, he has influenced me. I have understood that he is alive and that he came to show us how to think, how to behave, how to react to people, to circumstances, how to appreciate the life that the Lord, that God has given us. You see, he can influence you in the simplest way of living your life, in the daily life. That's how Jesus has changed my life. From a selfish way of living to now, a way of caring about people, about my actions, about how can I affect other people around me. That's how Jesus has changed my life.
My life before I became a follower of Jesus, it was a period in which I was consumed by the love of money. My name is Manoj and this is my story. I was a businessman, a property trader, and my whole world revolved around trying to buy as many blocks as I could throughout the UK to essentially make the most amount of money that I could physically make in my lifetime. In terms of my business, 2008 was going to be the big year for us. But then we all know what happened in 2008. The mortgage market collapsed. For me, the credit crunch was like literally being in an earthquake. Everything just started to crumble overnight. It was during that same time that my son also became ill. He was rushed to hospital and he was rushed into resuscitation, where essentially he stopped breathing and there were all kinds of complications. But what do you do when you're ushered into the room next door? I turned to God in the hope that he would somehow come and help us. My son was transferred to St. Thomas's in London. And then the consultant comes and sees us on the fourth day and says, I'm really sorry, but you know, your son is not going to open his eyes for some time yet. They're still trying to work out what was going on. And yet what was resonating throughout the 4 days was the fact that this American couple that had come over from the States, we'd recently befriended them and they were praying. It really impacted me because they called us so many times and talked about the church lifting up my son in prayer. And it really gave me a lift. And what really, really impacted me was the fact that this lady in particular collapsed on the floor and wept for my son. There was something there that I felt that she had that was different. So on that fourth day, the consultant had said to us, your son is not going to open his eyes for some time yet. And as she did the ward round, my son suddenly just bolted, literally just bolted upright in bed. And as you can imagine, there's so much elation and there's so much joy. And I remember turning to my wife and said to her that, you know, when we get out of this hospital, let's just go to that couple's church that prayed for our son. It was a big sort of experience that I had in that church, in the sense that I literally walked out a different person. My wife really didn't recognize me. My mother thought I'd joined some kind of cult because suddenly I wanted to try and do everything differently, particularly in the area of business. Before that, I was very, very arrogant, very ruthless, very money driven. And for, as someone who had essentially lived such a sinful life, and in the midst of all of that sin, there's a God that says, I forgive you and I'm going to wipe the slate clean. Now, how do you get your head around that?
My sin was great, your love was greater. some time ago, I was being interviewed. It sort of happens in this job. And the interviewer made it very, very clear that she did not believe in God. And certainly, if there was a God, Jesus was nothing to do with God. And she picked up on a phrase used by someone else famously a few years ago in England, who said, "We don't do God." And she said, "I don't do God." And I said, "Yes, but God does you." The point about becoming a Christian is not that we grit our teeth, screw up all our good intentions and live better lives while saying some prayers that we don't really understand to someone we've never really met for the rest of our life in the hope that it'll pay off afterwards. That's a sort of caricature of what it is. To become a Christian is to allow the fact that God is reaching out to us to be realized by us stretching out our hand and saying, "Yes, I want to follow you, to belong to you, to be your disciple. Yes, I've gone wrong. Yes, I'm a bit of a mess. In the dark nights, I know that. I've made lots of wrong choices. I may be in the middle of some. But, Lord, save me." And the extraordinary thing is, wherever we're coming from, however bad we are, however good we are, whatever we're like, we find his hand slipping into ours, and he begins to lead us on a lifetime journey that goes on beyond life, forever in his presence, a journey of perfect love.
After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishing. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him.
The Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I?
We've been thinking about the fact that the church is a bit like Cinderella, living in poverty, distant from the Father. And so what we've been doing is unveiling the bride and looking at the true beauty of the church. We looked at the fact that we are a family, that we are brothers and sisters. And throughout the book of Acts, it talks about the church being brothers, being sisters, that we're related, that we share community, that we have wonderful fellowship together with God and with each other. Last week we looked at the wonderful fact that we are believers, that we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and we come into that saving relationship with him. Well, when we believe, we also looked at the fact that it's not just a once only initial belief, but it's an ongoing belief where we continue to believe and experience the power and the love of God. And that is the journey of what we're looking at this week. To go on believing is to be a disciple of Jesus. I've got some questions for you. What is a disciple of Jesus? What's the difference between a Christian and a disciple? Is it possible to be a Christian
without being a disciple? To answer the first of those questions, we think about what it means to be a disciple. Not just a disciple of Jesus, but a disciple of anything. It means to be an apprentice, to be a learner, to go on a journey to learn something. So, for example, if you want to learn the piano, you go to a piano teacher and you become a disciple. You learn to play the piano. Now, you know that when you go to play the piano, you don't just turn up for your first lesson and then at the end of that lesson, you can learn the piano. Or if you want to learn swimming, you don't just go to the pool, jump in, and the teacher says, right, that's it, okay, you can swim. You have to go through a process of learning and you are trained. It's about being trained. It's about being on a journey. And the word apprentice is a very good word because it describes how we learn to do something over a period of time when we're actually in relationship with somebody else and they are modeling and teaching us how to do this. It implies that we're on a journey and it implies that we go on doing it, okay? It's very closely linked to the word discipline. Disciple, discipline. And it's a very similar word. It basically means to be trained. When we discipline our children, it doesn't mean that we tell off our children. It means that we train our children in the way that they should go. And they undergo a process of being disciplined. They are being prepared for life. They are being equipped for life. And so when we are a disciple of Jesus, we are a learner, we are an apprentice, we go on believing in the journey. It's a long obedience in the same direction in which we are being trained and equipped and prepared to live the life that he wants us to live. The second question is, what is the difference between a Christian and a disciple? Well, this may surprise some of you to know this, but in the Bible, the word Christian is very rarely used, I think twice. And whenever the word Christian is used, it means a disciple. So in other words, disciples went on to become known as Christians. So initially there were the 12 disciples, but then of course there were many more disciples, and those disciples were told to make disciples. And so every disciple is a follower of Jesus, somebody who's come into relationship with him, believes in him, trusts in him, and have given their life to being an apprentice, to going on this journey where they're following him, submitting to him, to his lordship. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and we are saved, and we believe, we go on believing. That's what it means to be a disciple. There is no other category of believer. You cannot be a Christian without being a disciple. So the first step is this: are you a disciple? Are you committed to following Jesus? Not just statically. Sometimes when we use the word Christian, we kind of imply it as you either are a Christian or you're not a Christian, as though it's something that you just are. And maybe some people might say, well, I was born in Britain, or I'm Church of England, or I go to church, or something like that, which describes being a Christian. That doesn't make anybody a Christian. The first step is this: are you a disciple? Have you given your life to Jesus? Do you believe in him? Is he the Lord? Is he the one who saves you? Is he your king? Are you submitting to his kingdom? And in that case, you are a disciple. You are on that journey. And then you can be known as a Christian, somebody who has Christ, the name Messiah, locked into your name, that you are a follower of Christ. So being a disciple is somebody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ and they put their trust in him and they are following him. They are on a journey. They are learning. They're an apprentice. And every day he is speaking to them and showing them how to live. It's the most exciting way to live, to be a disciple of Jesus. And there are two parts to being a disciple. When Jesus called the first disciples, he said this, "Come, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people." Come, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. There are two parts to Jesus' call to be a disciple. First part is an invitation. Come and follow me. Come and be with Jesus. And this is an invitation to be with Jesus. He welcomes us. He accepts us. He is inclusive. He says, come and be with me. Come and receive my love. Receive my forgiveness. Receive my grace. Come to me, says Jesus, and I will give you rest. There's a wonderful invitation to be with Jesus. That's the first part of his call to be a disciple, that we are with him. And no matter what happens, we will never lose that relationship with him, that he loves us and he accepts us and he gives us his help. The second part to his call is this. There is a challenge. There is an invitation. Come follow me. There is a challenge. And I will send you out to fish for people, says Jesus. So he is saying, come and be with me. And I'm going to prepare you and equip you and send you out to do my work. To fish for people. To make more disciples. To help other people believe in me. To help other people to know me. So there is a challenge. That's hard. Wow. How do we respond to the challenge? Well, first we need to receive the invitation to come and follow him. But then we receive the challenge. But as we follow him, as we learn, as we grow in relationship with him, he is sending us out to do his work, to bring his kingdom, because we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the Messiah. And his kingdom is at work and we are citizens of that kingdom. And so he's saying, I am sending you to do my work. So to follow Jesus, there is an invitation and a challenge to be a disciple. An invitation, come follow me, and a challenge, and I will send you out. There is a covenant, a relationship. It's about a relationship with God, but it's also about a kingdom. It's a covenant and a kingdom. I will send you out to fish for people. Now, which of those two are you strongest in? Are you strongest in the invitation? You want to spend time with Jesus and be with him? Or are you strongest in the challenge to go out? And actually, we need both of them to be a disciple. And our church needs to have both of these in it. We cannot just be a church that we welcome and we include and we say, come and be with Jesus, and that's all there is to it. No, because we need to actually have his sending us out into the world to be his people. That's a challenge. But we cannot either just focus on the challenge without being with Jesus, because being with Jesus is where we receive his help and his love and his acceptance and his power, so that we can go and do the work. So which of those two is the biggest challenge for you? Receive Jesus today and hear these words to you. Come, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. So we are a family of brothers and sisters. We are believers. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are disciples. We are ones who go on believing and we follow Jesus. We don't just believe, but we follow. That means we do what he says. So the most important question that we can ask each other is this: what is Jesus saying to you? What is Jesus saying to you? And then the next question is this: what are you going to do about it? What is Jesus saying to you? What are you going to do about it? And that is what being a disciple is all about. That is what discipleship is all about. Now, you may have already realized this. You can't be a disciple on your own. You can't be a footballer on your own. You need to play in a team. Everything we need to do in with each other to support each other. So being a disciple is a personal thing. It's a personal relationship, but it's not a private thing. We do it with other people. So the first thing is we need to do this personally. You and I need to spend time every day with Jesus on our own, close the door, and we need to listen to him. We need to read the Bible. And we need to hear his voice to us today and say, what are you saying to me today, Jesus? And then we need to ask the question, what do you want me to do? What's the challenge? How am I going to put it into practice today? And then we can do that with other people. Let me encourage you to do that with two or three other people, to be in a discipling relationship. What that means is we encourage each other. You could do that over WhatsApp. You can do that by phoning each other. You can do that by meeting up when the coronavirus is over. And we can share with each other what Jesus is saying to us. And we can encourage each other to put into practice what he's telling us to do. That is a discipling relationship. And so I want to encourage you to be a disciple this week, to live for him, to spend time on your own listening to him, and then to encourage other people to be disciples. The important thing that we realize about being a disciple is it's about loving God with all of our heart and our mind and our soul and our strength. It's about loving each other, loving God and loving each other, loving our neighbours. Now, that's a disciple of Jesus, and that's the greatest commandment that Jesus ever gave, to love God and to love your neighbour. But in order to fulfil that great commandment, we need the great commission. Jesus said, make disciples of all nations. If you and I are a disciple, we love God, we love our neighbour, that is wonderful, but that will not help other people to be disciples. We need to make other disciples. We need to help other people to follow God, to love each other. And so discipleship is not just an individual pursuit. It is a group activity in which we share our lives with others and we journey together. Together we are following Jesus. Together we are hearing his voice. Together we are learners, apprentices on the journey. And he will be shaping and changing each one of us as we go on that journey. So being a disciple of Jesus is the most exciting journey that we can be on, in which we believe in God. We love God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength. Remember that picture of the house being our life, and we invite Jesus into our life, into all the rooms of our life. And so discipleship is the intentional invitation of Jesus into all of the areas of our life, into my family, into my relationships, into my finances, into my hopes and dreams, into my work, into my thought life, into my passions, into my leisure time. Whatever it is, we are inviting Jesus into those areas. And being this, what does it mean to follow Jesus in those areas? Jesus, what are you saying to me about that area? And so can I encourage you on that journey to hand over the keys to Jesus and say, Jesus, I want to be a disciple. I want to follow you on this journey. I give over to you now every area of my life, and I want to follow you and be a disciple in those areas. And then the next question I want to ask you this week is, who can I help to follow Jesus with me? Who is God calling you to help to follow Jesus? And maybe the first step is to say, could somebody help me to follow Jesus? And then we journey together to help each other, to support each other, so that we pray for that person, so that we love that person, so that we help that person to go through the journey that we're going through. There's lots and lots of people that we need to make disciples of, but let's just start with one. Who is it, God, that you are calling me to help to become a disciple of you? Help me to know the first step to do that. Amen. We used to sing a song years ago that said, I've decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Lord Jesus, I give my life to you today, to follow you, to believe in you, but to go on believing in you as a disciple. Today, Lord, I give over every aspect of my life to your Lordship. I want to learn. I want to grow. I want to be an apprentice. What are you saying to me today? I respond to your invitation to come and follow you. And I respond to the challenge for you to send me out to help other people to follow you. I pray for this week that I may live for you and I may help other people live for you in my family, with my neighbours, in my community, in my workplace, wherever I am, as a disciple of Jesus. Amen.
Though none go I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning.
Such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Jesus, we give you our praise. You're our greatest prize, our greatest treasure, and we will forsake everything for the joy of knowing you. We worship you alone in this place.
All I have to be.
God bless you today. May you go and be a blessing. May you put into practice what Jesus is calling to you to do as his disciple. May his protection, his health, and his healing be upon you and upon your family and wherever you go this week. You are blessed to be a blessing. Go in the name of Jesus. Amen.